Absolutely. That's lovely. How long do you want in total when you add all that up? Okay. Great. I probably didn't even jot down enough, so. Perfect. Welcome to opening round coverage of the National Invitation Tournament. It's the first round of the NIT here at the Sewell Center on the campus of Robert Morris as the number one overall seed. Kentucky has to go on the road, oddly enough, as they take on the Colonials. Hi again, everyone. Bob Wischusen alongside Jimmy Dykes and the number one overall seed. What did they get as their reward? Well, they get to go on the road to take on Robert Morris in a jam-packed building. The rest of the games in our portion of the bracket we played a little bit later on tomorrow night, something like that. I will, yeah, I'll do a better job of that. With Rupp Arena being, you know, host to the NCAA tournament. I agree. I mean, I know, you know, do you want me to refer to any of those other games, or it didn't really make difference? All right, that's fine. So the rest of our bracket will be played tomorrow night. Hi again, everyone. Bob Wischusen alongside Jimmy Dykes, and Allison Williams will join us in just a moment. This is the oddest of sporting events, as you've got the number one overall seed and a lot of friends here to watch them as technically the home team playing in Robert Morris's gym, something like that. Yeah.
Kentucky's going to have, it's not like I'm in a can, guys. This isn't going to work. Kentucky's going to have their hands full. A team that make eight threes a game, 38%. Gym's going to be hot, Bob. And Kentucky, how much fight do they have? Something John Calipari's questioned all year.
And it really is David versus Goliath as we go to the one-on-one.
Well, for Kentucky, you have a history behind you, but you also have a Robert Morris team that got to get there quicker than that. You know, they've had some success of their own, Robert Morris. They've been to two NCAAs in the last 6 years, two NIT appearances. Again, this is a veteran ball club that I don't think they're going to be afraid of the moment. For Kentucky, the winningest program in the history of college basketball, that does nothing for them tonight. This is a Robert Morris team that is an older squad. They've won the NEC Championship regular season title. They will not be easy to take out.
As we take a look at the starting lineup, and for Robert Morris, they'll bring Velton Jones and Carvell Anderson, two of their best all-around guards off the bench. But it's a junior-laden group, something along those lines, and the defending national champions on the road. Blah, 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 we got the end. Yep. We got the anthem.
Test 1-2, 1-2, 3-4.
Thank you.
The fastest national. Test 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. It's a little better. Test 1, 2. Bob, let me hear you, buddy.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
Yeah,
is that all right?
Bob is a lot hotter than me in my headset.
Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
Okay. Test 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
At the Charles Sewell Center tonight, the Fire Chief must have a terrific seat at midcourt because whatever capacity is here at the Chuck, it has been exceeded. And why not? The biggest game ever to take place on the campus of Robert Morris. The winningest program in the history of college basketball is here. It's Kentucky, the number one overall seed in the NIT, set to meet the Colonials as we will begin the National Invitation Tournament. Now, to an amazing scene inside the Sewell Center. They have been lined up since the early parts of the afternoon to get a coveted seat to watch the winningest program in the history of college basketball come to this barely over 3,000 seat gym as Kentucky and Robert Morris will open up the NIT. Now the Wildcats are the number one overall seed, and their reward, well, they've got Rupp Arena preparing for games later this week. So Kentucky technically is the home team that has to go on the road to take on Robert Morris, but it gives us this atmosphere, and it is terrific. The rest of the games in our portion of the bracket will be played tomorrow night. If Kentucky wins, they'll go back to Rupp to face either Charlotte or Providence. Hi again, everyone. Bob Wischusen alongside Jimmy Dykes. Allison Williams will join us in just a moment. It's hard to imagine a better atmosphere for any college basketball game during tournament time than the one we'll have tonight. And Kentucky gets welcomed as the home team, technically.
Think about Kentucky. In the last 12 months, they've gone from the national championship to Moon Township. That's where we are right now for Kentucky. They better be ready to play because they're up against a veteran squad, Robert Morris. They know how to win, a culture of winning in this program. They've averaged 23, 24 wins over the last 5 years, and they can flat out shoot the basketball from three.
As we take a look at our one-on-one, in terms of the historical nature of these two programs, we couldn't get more of a David versus Goliath.
No, absolutely right, Bob. I mean, Robert Morris, again, they've been the NCAA tournament two out of the last 6 years. They know how to win ball games. They're built to win games on big stages. They're not afraid of the moment. For Kentucky, 8-8 national championships, and all those wins does them no good tonight. Robert Morris is a veteran squad that will have an edge and a toughness about them that will really test this young Kentucky team.
Here's the starting lineup, first of all, for technically, again, the visiting group, the Robert Morris Colonials. They'll start Anthony Myers-Pate and Caron Williams in the backcourt, but Velton Jones and Carvell Anderson are two terrific upperclassmen guards that will be coming off the bench in short order. And Jimmy, a lot of pressure continues to fall to Willie Cauley-Stein as Nerlens Noel went down back on February the 12th, and they just haven't been the same without him. Let's check in with Allison.
Hey, Bob. Earlier today, both head coaches expressed different concerns about the emotion of their team. Head coach for Kentucky, John Calipari, warned there could be a letdown. So last night when he addressed his team, he held up the Kentucky jersey. He said, you see this name on the front? This ignites and excites opposing teams, players, programs. Have pride in that. But also have pride in the name on the back of your jersey. Play for yourself and your families. On the other end, Robert Morris head coach Andy Toole wants to make sure his players don't focus on those names. He said the biggest thing for us mentally to overcome will be to not focus on who we are playing. He said, you see the name on the front and on the back, it can make you uncomfortable. Tonight, he told his players, be yourself and play your game.
It really is fascinating thinking about the different mental challenges that these two programs have tonight, Jimmy. You've got Kentucky. They're not supposed to be the NIT. They live in the NCAA tournament. They won the national championship last season. And yet you would think this atmosphere would ignite them. And for Robert Morris, how do you stay inside your skin in this atmosphere against one of the historical programs in the country?
If you're Robert Morris and you don't make the NCAA tournament, this would be number one on your wish list, to get Kentucky, the all-time winning program in the history of college ball, on your home floor. An opportunity that they are not going to take for granted.
First shot missed by Harrell from the corner, and a nice wall off underneath by Mike McFadden. The undersized Colonials, but they're a tough ball club. You had them earlier this season, and their effort level made an impression on you.
Very impressed when they went on the road and played at Arkansas, a 4 or 5 point game, but they play extremely hard, and they shoot the ball extremely well, making over 8 3-point shots per game, 40% as a team on their home floor.
Anthony Myers Pate. That jump shot breaks the ice. Carly Stein turns it over, a takeaway. Russell Johnson comes the other way. He allows the flyby. An offensive rebound. Lucky Jones draws the foul.
Now, Robert Morris offensively, they run a lot of ball screen action, a lot of dribble handoff action. And if you're not alert, if you're not ready, you're going to get picked off and allow open 15-foot shots on the curls and wide open threes. A formula to get beat on this floor if you're Kentucky.
Wally Stein was the guilty party on that foul, so that's the first foul of the game. Straight away for Williams. Knocks down a triple.
Bob,
it's 5-0 Robert Morris.
You cannot, I'm telling you, cannot have your hands down on the perimeter against Robert Morris. Hands down, vision of the rim, they're going to let it fly.
Let it fly from the left wing, no good. As Julius Mays came up short. And here come the Colonials on the attack again. From the corner this time, Lucky Jones a little too strong.
Robert Morris is a shrink-the-gap defensive ball club. That's what they've been all year. They don't have to change what they've done all season against Kentucky. That's how you defend the Wildcats. Push out on Mays, push out on Wilcher, shrink the floor on all the other spots.
Carly Stein's kick pass was deflected off the side of the backboard. Pull up straight away and bottoming out for Russell Johnson. And John Calipari already wants a timeout.
Robert Morris has made a school record 284 threes this season. This is what they do. Mays with his hands down, staring at the waist, and gets burned. And then the turnover, and Robert Morris off to the races. You have to get your toes outside that three-point line defensively. Kentucky doesn't do it in their conversion defense. And it's 7-0, bam, right off the bat.
If not for better three-point shooting against Mount St. Mary's, Robert Morris might have won the Northeast Conference Tournament as well as the NEC regular season championship, but they were all around the best three-point shooting team in their league this year, number 5 overall in scoring, and number 1 in their league in points per game allowed defensively. So in spite of the fact that they like to get up and down the floor, they're a team that scores in the low 70s, did a pretty good job at the defensive end. It's not one of those system defensive teams that slows it down and holds you down as a result. They like to play a fast-paced game, and still they hold you down and score.
Robert Morris has a bunch of guys that are wired for offense. And they have not always guarded the entire 35 seconds. Now, when they've gone to the NCAA tournaments 2 out of the last 6 years, they had teams that would guard for 65 seconds if they had to. If Robert Morris guards in the half court, a terrific chance to win this ball game.
Archie Goodwin has it knocked away, recovers it midcourt, now they call it an over and back.
Kentucky being bothered by the heat and the pressure of Robert Morris early, not owning their spots, not sweeping with the basketball to get the pressure off or to knock it off. Three early turnovers for Kentucky.
Cauley Stein out, and the sixth man of the year in the SEC, Kyle Wiltshire, comes on for the first time. And here's Belton Jones, the senior point guard that really is the straw that stirs the drink for the Colonials, coming off the bench. Normally a starter, has a shoulder injury, so they're trying to limit his minutes if they can.
But he's a very physical point guard. He's number two in blue. The kind of point guard that you don't want to mess with. And he and Ryan Harrell will go nose to nose in this ball game. Will Ryan Harrell stand up?
Wiltshire fouled by Russell Johnson. That's the first foul against Robert Morris.
It's almost like Robert Morris has sniffed out early that Kentucky doesn't have the blow-by ability. Archie Goodwin, number 10 in white, can do it, but really no one else for Kentucky. It doesn't look that Andy Toole has any concern with getting out and heating up that basketball.
How hard is it to prepare as a coach for a game like this? Short notice for your opponent, and also two conferences that these two opposing coaches probably have no familiarity with.
Bob, all you can do is go over tendencies in your scouting report, try to know personnel, who you're guarding, but really it just boils down to who wants the ball tonight. If you don't want to play in this environment, then you don't have a pulse.
Alex Poitras fouled on the floor. That'll go against Stephen Hawkins. A sloppy start for Kentucky. And it gets sloppier as they turn it over on the inbound, unless they call the foul, and it looks as if they may have. They did call a foul against the Colonials. Looks like that'll go against Belton Jones. So it stays with Kentucky.
This gym has looked like this for the past hour. I mean, we walked into Chance an hour and a half before the ball game. The Chant is overrated. Well, first of all, Kentucky's not rated, so you can't be overrated, right?
I thought they were talking about us.
But that's probably where it was.
Really, I tend to agree. Poitras faces up, tend to shoot. Triple team, and has it taken away by Lucky Jones. Tries to go coast to coast, right at Wiltshire. Score the basket, plus the foul. Chance for a three-point play for Lucky Jones. Robert Morris is pitching a shutout.
And lucky he is, with some skill as well. Boy, from the opening tip, the guys in blue have been hot defensively, driving the ball at Kentucky, and John Calipari has his hands full.
Great.
No? Wow, now I'm really a little hot now. Golly.
Jimmy called it.
Test 1-2, 1-2, 1-2, 3-4, 5-6, 7-8.
Said they were in trouble.
Kentucky plays at Rupp Arena, 23,000 people. Well, tonight they're on the... Kentucky plays at Rupp Arena, 23,000 people. Well, tonight they're on the road at the Chuck. Robert Morris versus Kentucky. Hey, this thing's sold out. You know why? The Chuck only seats 3,000 people. John Calipari has his own office in the locker room at Rupp. Well, tonight he will meet with his coaches right here in the corner. But the focal point of their trophy case just outside the locker room, the Marshall Memorial Key Centurion Classic, runner-up 1990. Kentucky and Robert Morris. Row 25 in the corner for 15 pucks. Now that's a bargain.
A little look at the Sewell Center with Jimmy Dykes. That's about halfway up the lower bowl at Rupp Arena. And you're in the last row here at the Sewell Center. The student section outnumbers the entire arena here by about 2,000 here at Rupp.
That? This is it kind of has the feeling of the 3A state championship game when you can't get another person in the local gym. That's what Kentucky has walked into tonight.
I guarantee you there are more than 3,056
Absolutely.
People in this building tonight. And as I said at the start, I wouldn't be surprised if we saw the fire chief sitting right at midcourt. Got to give him a good seat tonight. Derek Colson one-on-one. Gets to the baseline, bounces it through traffic, gets a return, and finally Kentucky. Nearly 5 minutes in is on the board.
You know what I like about Jared Colson? He checks in. He's not afraid of the moment. He drives the basketball, tries to make a play, makes a pass, spaces out, knocks down a shot. Will the rest of his team follow his lead?
Delton Jones leans in. In and out. Gets his own miss. What a touch pass underneath for the layup. Mike McFadden finishes. That was all Delton Jones.
That describes Felton Jones. I mean, no one competes harder than this kid in the NEC. All NEC first team member and a durable point guard. Just tough as nails.
Wiltshire leans in and he is rejected by Hawkins.
Bob, that's an easy shot to block. They're running isolation for Wiltshire. Very slow developing, very slow footwork. Telling everybody on the floor, I'm going to shoot the ball when I get my shoulders towards the rim, and it gets chewed up. Nothing will come easy for Kentucky, and they better do it at a quicker step, a quicker pace than they've tried so far. Robert Morris early, quicker at all five spots.
Cauley Stein back in for Wiltshire. And John Hood has come on for the first time. Shot clock at 8. Paulson drives it again, flips it up and scores. So all 4 points for the Wildcats to Jared Paulson.
Why has Paulson been successful? He's stuck his nose in there. He's not afraid to, you know, make a play.
Another jumper goes down for Anthony Myers Pate.
The formula to beat Kentucky all season long, Bob, has been make them defend the fourth, the fifth, the sixth pass by moving and cutting and ball reversal. If Robert Morris does that, they're going to advance in this opening round of the NIT.
Poitras able to recover and stuff it home. A friendly bounce as it looked like Russell Johnson had a steal.
Andy Toole talked to his guys today at the shoot-around. Offensively, what do we want? We want to get to the fourth, the sixth pass. Get two or three different sides of the floor touched. Make this young Kentucky team work.
Air ball that Williams tries to save. Carvell Anderson comes up short.
You cannot melt on the screens of Robert Morris. They're a very good physical screening team. Kentucky has to communicate. They can't melt on the action, and so far they've done it two or three times and resulted in wide open curls for Robert Morris.
Great record in March for John Calipari. I'm Bob Wischusen alongside Jimmy Dykes. We walked out of the shoot-around today, and on our way out the door, especially after we saw Robert Morris, you raised your eyebrows, said, you know what, there's a pretty good chance Kentucky might be in some trouble tonight. And already Robert Morris has certainly delivered the first punch up by 6.
Well, I thought so because the shoot-around for Robert Morris was alive, was active. They were touching each other. They were talking. there was a vibe about Robert Morris, an excitement level that you seldom see in the first night of the NIT. Guys are trying to, you know, not have their dauber down, and this club does not, I promise.
Another three. That one for Caron Williams. Olson gets to the baseline, stepped on the end wall.
The pin down action of Robert Morris offensively, Bob, caused a lot of problems. It's just simple. I mean, there it is. You're getting a pin down, guys popping out. This time it's Hood, not down, not alert, not talking through any type of switching action. And the home team getting a lot of high percentage looks.
Kentucky's the Yankees. When they go on the road, they're going to get the crowd, the sellout. Everywhere in the SEC, they're an event when they come to town.
Sure.
Against the teams they play every year. Obviously, they're a huge event tonight. Having said all that, for a team that always seems to play in a sold-out atmosphere, is this atmosphere of only, say, 3,500 people getting to them, do you think, early? Or is this more just to credit the effort level of Robert Morris?
I think it's a little bit of both. You know, especially the first 4 minutes, I think the atmosphere was into Kentucky. Now, to me, they've settled down a little bit the last couple of minutes. I know this. If you play for Kentucky and you're afraid of this moment tonight in this atmosphere, you need to leave. You need to go somewhere else. You need to go to another school. You need to go to the NBA or something. But if you're afraid of this atmosphere tonight and you play for Kentucky, it's not for you. You need to go somewhere else.
This is a homecoming for John Calipari. We've got some terrific looks at it when we come back.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by Wendy's. Proud sponsor of the 2013 John R. Wooden Men's Player of the Year Award. The Experience Buick Lease. It's a new lease on luxury. And Match.com. People who join Match.com are three times more likely to find a relationship than people who don't.
We sped it up a bit, but that's actually the drive from the campus of Robert Morris to what is now the middle school here in Moon Township, but it was the high school when John Calipari went there. And there is the gym that he used to sneak into to practice on the weekends, where he made the magic happen. He was a member of the Moon Tigers. This is the homecoming for John Calipari. And of course, in the yearbook office, when we took a ride over to the school earlier today, they had just what we were looking for. Short shorts, a lot of hair. We knew he played basketball. We had no idea that he, when he was the student council president, decided to honor the office with a Saturday Night Fever look-alike suit. He was also the prom king of the junior prom back in 1977. And he actually said that you could, from certain spots where he grew up, some of his relatives' houses, see the building we're in right now from their yards.
Absolutely. His grandmother worked on this Robert Morris campus when it was a junior college in the kitchen. And Cal said he would go over to the outdoor courts and play ball for 2 or 3 hours every day and then make his way to the back door of the kitchen, and Grandma would feed him lunch.
Fade away off the window, no good for Belton Jones.
See, I sense Kentucky has settled in to this atmosphere just the last two or three minutes. Archie Goodwin just throwing a shot instead of shooting a shot.
A tie up and a kick ball will be called on John Hood. So it will stay with Robert Morris. We'll check in with Allison.
Well, Bob, right now, Coach Calipari not enjoying the homecoming because of the performance of his team. A couple of things he's getting after them about: a lack of compete. The four turnovers they had early, they now have five. They feel like it's because they're not competing hard enough. And he also told them right now they are not tough enough out there.
Allison, toughness has been an issue at times with certain players this year that John Calipari has questioned, although that time Willie Cauley-Stein tough in the lane. But then Ryan Harrow bought the pump fake from Russell Johnson, and Johnson will go to the free throw line.
Well, to me, the bottom line with toughness is you do what's right when it's really hard to do what's right. And that kind of sums up a lot of things in life and on the basketball floor. You know, it's hard to talk on defense when you're missing shots. It's hard to blow up screens defensively when things aren't going your way. It's hard to sit in a stance and, you know, own your spot. And those are the things that John Calipari is continuing to have to coach and teach right now. If you're having to teach effort and listening in March, you're in trouble.
Harrow out, Olsen back in for the Cats. But they trail by eight. Coming up on the midway point of the first half.
What I tell you earlier today, 3 weeks ago when I saw that John Calipari ditched his practice plans and they played dodgeball, I said they're in trouble. John Calipari having to push all the buttons, and no team wants to have to break off and play dodgeball late in March. That's not where you want to be as a squad.
Boyd was way short from the corner. Offensive rebound, Cauley-Stein able to put it home.
Bob, he needs to become the guy. He's 7 feet tall. Robert Morris is a club that wants to front the post. He should get a ton of touches in this game and put up big numbers. Will he do it, and will Kentucky get him the ball?
Moving screen called on Keith Armstrong as he bumped Cauley-Stein.
When Nerlens Noel went down with that knee injury, Willie Cauley-Stein was thrown into a position that he really wasn't ready for. But he has grown, you know, about week by week, and he can block shots. But boy, without Nerlens Noel, I know what the numbers say, but here's what they lost. They lost their one guy that had a swagger, that had a vibe about him, that had a fight about him. And he was starting to drag this young Kentucky team with him when he went down in Gainesville on that Tuesday night. And they have not replaced that vibe, that swagger, that fight that they lost with Nerlens Noel.
Foul called on Anthony Myers. Pate. 15 foul against Robert Morris here in the first half. Archie Goodwin has it knocked away and taken away. Carvell Anderson brings it back. All alone, it's Williams. And over the back, a foul will be called on Lucky Jones. Well, the 2013 NCAA Women's Basketball Championship tips off Saturday at 11 a.m. Eastern on ESPN2, online at ESPN3. You can catch every moment of the tournament on the ESPN family of networks and find information on every championship at NCAA.com, the home for all 89 NCAA championships.
Bob, look out there right now. Willie Cauley-Stein is 7 feet. He's being guarded by a guy that's 6'7", running to the block, post up, and make plays, and that's what he needs to do.
Olsen up to Cauley-Stein. Terrific setup as the junior finds the freshman.
Jared Polson is going to get a lot of minutes in this ball game because John Calipari is going to play guys that are tough.
Jumper comes up way short for Myers Pate. And Kentucky can pull possibly within two, if not within a one possession game.
Well, there's a mismatch. I mean, it's either Wilt or Willie Cauley-Stein. Who do you want to post up?
Here's Cauley-Stein with a sloppy shovel pass that's stolen by Carvell Anderson. And then a foul called in the backcourt against Wiltshire.
Again, Jared Polson now for the second time has driven the ball baseline with a purpose. Nice vision, a nice feel for where 15 and White's going to be right in front of the rim. And I couldn't get enough touches for Collie Stein or Wiltshire right now in this ball game when Wiltshire's on the floor because of the size around the rim.
Questioning the maturity, the toughness, the swagger of freshmen, that often happens with freshmen at other programs.
It does.
But is it somewhat unfair the way we look at freshmen at Kentucky because of the freshmen that have preceded this group, that we don't allow them to just be freshmen? Because they're not supposed to be at Kentucky. They're supposed to come in and get you to the Sweet 16, if not maybe the Final Four, and win a national championship. That's what the freshmen before them have done.
I think that's a really, really good point. I mean, Archie Goodwin has been Kentucky's, you know, leading scorer, 14 points a game. I know he's only an 18% three-point shooter. There's a lot of stuff in his game that's not ready to ask to work on. But he's had a good freshman year. But he hasn't been Anthony Davis or Michael Kidd-Gilchrist or John Wall or Brandon Knight at that level. The level that John Calipari has had is not the level that John Calipari has right now. And that's why Kentucky finds himself in Moon Township and not in the other tournament.
We hope the rest of the NIT brings you somewhat of the atmosphere we have tonight here at Robert Morris, because this place has been packed for hours. And tomorrow night on ESPN2, the first round of the NIT continues at 7 Eastern. Indiana State will take on Iowa, and then Long Beach State meets Baylor. Both games also live on Watch ESPN tomorrow night. Again, the portion of our bracket will continue tomorrow night as the winner of Kentucky, Robert Morris, will advance to take on the winner of Providence and Charlotte. Tomorrow night, we'll see Arizona State, Detroit, and Baylor, Long Beach State, as we said, as well, across all of our ESPN networks. Bob Beschews and Jimmy Dykes and Allison Williams here in Moon Township, Pennsylvania, the campus of Robert Morris, watching the NEC champions host Kentucky. The number one overall seed in the tournament is Kentucky, but they're struggling technically as the home team, but on the road here at Robert Morris, as Kentucky, with Rupp Arena serving as a first-round site for the NCAA tournament, couldn't play in their home building. So this is their reward, Jimmy, for being the number one overall seed. You get to come to Robert Morris and play, and what you said earlier was a hot box of about 3,500 fans.
Bob, Kentucky not chasing Robert Morris off the three-point line. John Calipari, what did he tell his guys today? I want to see if Robert Morris can beat us making tough twos. Well, they have not had to take tough twos in this ball game yet. They've curled into clean twos, and they've reversed the ball and driven it to kickouts to get clean threes. Robert Morris has made clean twos and clean threes. Nothing tough so far about their looks.
Mike McFadden called for a moving screen. That's team foul number 7 against Robert Morris. So they are over the limit. And Kentucky will shoot free throws the rest of the first half. Wildcats with 5 fouls here in the first half. Robert Morris already tonight doing damage from 3.
2-3 zone by Robert Morris. Kentucky likes to slice action through it. Wiltshire not on the floor. It's a lot easier team to zone than when he's on the floor.
Olsen penetrates again and draws the foul. If you could take the spirit of 5 and white and transplant it into the rest of the roster, this might be a different team.
Now, you've seen spurts of it all season long, off and on, from Jared Polson. He's a kid that, you know, John Calipari trusts his heart and his will probably just as much, if not more, than his skill. He has not run from the moment. He's not shied away from this building so far tonight. He's stepped up. He's made plays. He's driven the ball at the teeth of the defense. He's been Kentucky's toughest playmaker so far.
This is the first year that Jared Polson really has become a factor for Kentucky. In his junior year, averaged over 13 minutes a game this season and played in every game. In his first 2 years, he barely played. Didn't even play 2 minutes a game as a freshman. Did not play 3 minutes a game as a sophomore. But this year has a role. As he sits back down, and Ryan Harrell comes back on.
See if Robert Morris gets this ball from side to side. Kentucky's a young team, and young guys, they break down when things get uncomfortable. There's the second side of the floor.
And an offensive rebound. Anthony Myers-Pate kicks it back out. Carvell Anderson, a long two. That won't go, and this time it's cleared by Pauly Stein. Harrow tries to go rim to rim. Can't finish, and an offensive foul is called. Belton Jones, with the shoulder injury and all, stepped in and took the charge.
Well, Harrow tries to bring it 94 feet. Well, that's an easy call to make by Felton Jones. Gets his feet outside the restricted arc. He's set before Harrow takes off. And Ryan Harrow now will sit with 2 personal fouls.
Russell Johnson tried to drive it, and it was knocked off his knee out of bounds. So the Colonials turn it over, but they have not at any point turned over the lead. It's been the young Andrew Toole, only 32 years old, took over for his mentor Mike Rice when Mike Rice was named the head coach at Rutgers. Andy Toole spent 3 years as the top assistant here at Robert Morris and was promoted after a little convincing had to be done to make sure that the powers that be realized he was the right man for the job.
A flagrant
foul is called on Felton Jones on the reach-in on Pauly Stein.
That's an easy call to make, not making an honest play on the basketball. And Willie Pauly Stein is going to have that advantage all game long. He's 7-1, and there's just a grab of the shorts and a grab of the shoulder. Felton Jones knew it as soon as he did it. A costly bad mistake by the senior guard.
Pauly Stein, though, this season only a 38% free throw shooter. Good sportsmanship by Felton Jones. Not only did he immediately go over to try and help Pauly Stein up, but even went over to the free throw line to apologize again for what he realized was the wrong play to make. And Pauly Stein can't make either.
Kentucky has struggled all season long, Bob, from the free throw stripe, a 64% team overall. Lost close games because of it at times. Their inability to win on the road, I think, really factored into the eyes of the selection committee. Interesting, their 2 best wins were without Nerlens Noel at home against Florida and Missouri, but it wasn't enough.
Goodwin draws the foul. So he'll go to the free throw line. We took a look at the difference in Kentucky with and without Nerlens Noel. You cover the SEC and have for many years. Having watched Kentucky this season with and without Nerlens Noel, you're pretty confident that they would have been an NCAA tournament team had he not been injured?
Well, think about this. They were 17-6 when he got injured. They had won five in a row, and at the time, Nerlens Noel was averaging 10 points, 9.5 boards, and almost 4.5 blocks per game. Those numbers, just the fifth time in Division I for a freshman to average in the last 40 years. He was right there on pace with Anthony Davis, Eddie Griffin from Seton Hall, O'Donnell Foyle from Colgate, and Ralph Sampson from Virginia. All those guys became top 10 picks, like Nerlens Noel is going to become as well. But more importantly, again, he was developing a fight and a mentality and a vibe about him that Kentucky did not have and has not replaced. They lost it, they haven't recaptured it, and because of it, they were an NCAA team with Noel, they're an NIT team without it.
Freshman of the year in the SEC and the defensive player of the year in the conference as well. That's a lot to lose. Russell Johnson hits a long two, toe on the line. So it's still a 6-point lead for Robert Morris. 9 points now for Russell Johnson. Wiltshire gives it up, and the baseline free for Archie Goodwin.
That was a good pass by Wiltshire, the right pass to make, not the extra pass. He saw that Goodwin had an easy one bounce all the way to the rack. Archie Goodwin took the rock to the rack.
A little shake and bake, and a friendly roll won't go for Myers Payton. Here comes Goodwin the other way. He'll attack again. Reach in, foul called. This one will go against Lucky Jones. That'll put Archie Goodwin back at the line.
The best thing Archie Goodwin does is attack off a one bounce with his right hand. He covers a lot of space with a big first step. And in transition, he's just as dangerous, bringing the ball with his right hand and bringing it at you. Robert Morris, the last time, Bob, they didn't load up the box and they weren't set. And if you're not set against Goodwin in conversion, he's going to get himself at the very least to the free throw stripe.
You know, talked to Andy Toole earlier today at Shoot Around, and we asked him about the significance of this game, being on campus, you get Kentucky, you don't make the NCAA tournament, but about the consolation prize of playing maybe the most historic program in America. And he said he knew it was different when he was on the selection show for the NIT on ESPNU. He gets off the air, and within 15 minutes of being on the selection show, he checks his email. He's got emails from Kentucky fans basically yelling at him, saying, "You have no shot. We're coming up there to kill you. We're going to bury you in your gym." He basically said that, you know it's a different kind of fan base when at 9:15 on a Sunday night, they're going to the Robert Morris website to find my email, to start shooting emails to the RMU head coach to talk trash.
There's not a more passionate fan base in all of college basketball. I mean, there's a good group of them over there across from us. You could have announced this game on Sunday night that on Tuesday, Kentucky's going to play in Tokyo. And there'd be a couple hundred fans there wearing blue. Wearing blue jerseys all over the downtown streets of Tokyo.
We are not lacking for atmosphere here at Robert Morris. First round of the NIT. All right, Chris, thanks very much. The Terps up by 9 right now in a game that's currently airing over on ESPN2 against Niagara. That portion of the bracket highlighted by Alabama as the number one seed. And the number one overall seed in the NIT is Kentucky. Not where they imagined that they would be at the start of the season, but Nerlens Noel hurt. And certainly not the gym they imagined playing in the NIT with Rupp Arena occupied. Kentucky in a dogfight with Robert Morris here on the road, but as the home team.
Well, and the home crowd has just thrown something onto the floor, which will probably result in the PA announcer saying, get a hold of yourself in certain terms. And Kentucky with 8 turnovers in this game, they've only made 8 shots, and that's a bad formula. They can clean up this end of the floor. Kentucky's size and athletes might be too much for Andy Toole's kids to handle.
And it looks like now they're going to hand the microphone, I think, to Andy Toole. And the head coach at Robert Morris is going to warn the crowd.
Throwing things on the floor. If you're here to support our team, support our team. Throwing things on the floor is going to hurt our team by getting us a technical. Thank you.
So message delivered by the 32-year-old head coach. Archie Goodwin to the line. That last foul called on Keith Armstrong, his second.
I've always wondered what would keep a Kentucky fan right now from going to buy a red Robert Morris t-shirt and going up here in the student section and throwing something on the floor.
Good job planting that seed. Kentucky began 1 of 4 at the free throw line, but they've made 6 of their last free throws in a row, and it's 8 straight points for Archie Goodwin to tie the game at 24. And now Goodwin will get a rest, replaced by John Hood. In his face, Russell Johnson comes up a little bit short. Kentucky with a chance to take their first lead.
Well, Robert Morris, their shot selection has gone down the last 4 or 5 minutes, taking some quick second and third pass jump shots, not making Kentucky work.
Cauley Stein to the baseline, comes up short, but losing it out of bounds was Caron Williams.
Bob, you have to play through contact in this game. Willie Cauley-Stein that time, there was some contact when he turned and got his shoulder square to the rim, but you have to play through it. Kentucky so far has not, and Robert Morris has.
Shot clock under 10. Olsen gives it up. Julius Mays lobs it. Cauley-Stein can't finish, but with 2 on the shot clock, does draw the foul.
Kentucky goes to their 51 action. They're 5 man setting a screen on the one guy. Willie Cauley-Stein, he's a sprint out screen. There's a 5-on-1 action, and then he makes a rim run. Kentucky doesn't roll out of that action, they rim run. And always a threat to throw it around the rim and let the size take over. And that's what this kid needs to do for Kentucky to close out this half and the entire second half. Let his length be too much for Robert Morris to check.
Let's see how Andy Toole uses his bench the rest of the way here in the first half as John Calipari brings Archie Goodwin back on. And John Hood will sit down. 5 different Robert Morris players now have 2 fouls. Williams becomes the latest to pick up his second. He goes to the bench. And a free throw finally goes for Cauley-Stein. The first lead for Kentucky with 2:45 to go here in the first half. Anderson gives it up, and the lead right back to Robert Morris as Anthony Myers-Pate is able to finish. A turnover for Kentucky.
Robert Morris running good offense. They'll drive the ball and they'll fill from behind. A little weave action is what it is, but the weave was really deep into the lane. You start running weave action and you're getting paint touches off of that weave action, you're going to get to the rim.
Kentucky with 9 first half turnovers. They only average about 13 turnovers per game. So it's been a sloppy first half for the Wildcats. Nearly a takeaway, and it is. They'll say that it's lost out of bounds by David Apollon.
Bob, Kentucky has gotten control over this building. And if they would cut down on their turnovers, they could really start doing some damage in this ball game. The atmosphere is not affecting Kentucky anymore.
Mays drives it, finds a backdoor cutter in Paulson. Or check that hood. John Hood able to finish, and that puts Kentucky back on top.
A nice read and pop out by Willie Cauley-Stein. When he popped, it created the drive angle, then a finish on the opposite side. Very well done by Kentucky in their half court. They're patient. Watch Willie Cauley-Stein. He pops. Mays reads. What does the pop do? It cleared out a baseline drive, and then Hood filled in from behind. If Willie Cauley-Stein doesn't pop and create that angle, then ultimately John Hood is not freed up at the rim.
Julius Mays called for the Kentucky foul. So that puts Carvell Anderson at the free throw line. A 1-1, and he's able to hit the front end. 17th foul called against Kentucky. And Robert Morris already up to 10, so it's the double bonus for the Wildcats.
You know what I like about this kid's game? He's led Robert Morris in scoring, and he's done it off the bench all season long. So he has a maturity factor about him. Doesn't bother him that his name's not called in the starting lineup. Gets up one shot every 2 minutes and 45 seconds. Does 15 in blue.
Mays for 3. A little too strong. Cauley-Stein tipped it. Right to Anthony Myers Pate, and a timeout called behind the play by Andy Toole. We'll step aside for 30 seconds and come right back to Robert Morris. The NBA on ESPN continues tomorrow night at 8 p.m. It's the Nets taking on the Mavs. NBA Wednesday presented by State Farm. Coverage tips off with Kia NBA Countdown at 7:30. Dallas against Brooklyn. Also live on Watch ESPN tomorrow night. See Darren Williams, Dirk Nowitzki. And it looks as if Anthony Myers Pate cramping up a bit, so he's going to take a seat. He'll be replaced with Velton Jones in the backcourt and Carvell Anderson as well. Myers Pate had a career high in the loss to Mount St. Mary's in the NEC championship game. He had 15.
Carvell Anderson should be involved in this sequence for Robert Morris. He's been their best scorer all season long. At the top of your screen, right in front of Kentucky's bench, being guarded by Mays. Here he is.
Anderson on the move, lost it on the way up, recovered in the lane by Velton Jones. Still 7 on the shot clock. A contested shot by Johnson is off the mark. And with the shot clock now turned off, Archie Goodwin races into the front court. Archie Goodwin attacks, just about turned it over. And Kentucky can settle things down. Wilson will do just that.
Where was Goodwin going? I mean, there was nowhere to go. He got bailed out by getting the ball back. Read the traffic.
And with the shot clock turned off, why not hold for 1? 5 seconds to go in the half. Holson lost it, trying to find it again. A scramble underway, and that'll take us to halftime. So Robert Morris started with the game's first 9 points, had a double-digit lead. Kentucky with 7 turnovers on their first 14 possessions. They did fight their way back at one point to take a lead of their own. But it's a one-point lead instead for Robert Morris at halftime as we check in with Allison. And we'll catch back up with Allison in just a moment as we are now at halftime here at what has been an electric atmosphere from 90 minutes before game time. There was not a seat empty in this place. And now we can check in with Allison.
Coach Cal, why has your team struggled to start this game?
Physical. They haven't played that physical. They don't stretch their defense out except my guards. So that what they did is they just got body to body and a couple guys couldn't be in the game. But, you know, we fought. We're hanging around. If we want to win the game, you're going to have to get lower. You're going to have to hold your post position. You have to fight. That's what basketball is.
What's the message going to be about the turnovers, 9 of them in the first half?
Get down. They're being physical. You're losing balls because they're up in you. So break down. You got to bend your legs and break through. You know, just it's all a toughness thing, which when we lost Nerlens, that's what's affected us more than anything else.
Thank you, Coach.
All right, Allison, thanks very much. Exactly the point that Jimmy Dykes made multiple times during the first half. Sounds like the point that John Calipari will be making to his team in the locker room. Time for Chris Cotter, Seth Greenberg, Jay Williams back in the studio with the halftime report. Chris? You're watching ESPN's coverage of college basketball. It's the NIT, and due to time constraints, we now move ahead in our action. You're watching ESPN's college basketball coverage of the NIT, and we'll come back after these messages. You're watching ESPN's college basketball coverage of the NIT. It is halftime, and the road to the national championship continues on ESPN with the Women's Final Four from New Orleans. Coverage begins Sunday, April 7th, with the NCAA Women's Championship Final Four special at 6 p.m. Eastern, and then on Tuesday, April 9th, the national championship game. Coverage starts that night at 7:30 Eastern. We'll come back with the second half of our game after this. Welcome back to round one of the NIT, the opening game for the number one overall seed. Kentucky trailing Robert Morris by a point. Kentucky, the number one overall seed, but having to play on the road here at Robert Morris, even though they're technically the home team, is Rupp Arena, tied up with the first round of the NCAA tournament. Bob Wischusen, Jimmy Dykes, Allison Williams, in what has been a great atmosphere. How has Kentucky handled it? They took that early punch early. Who was the advantage going to the second half?
Yeah, you heard Coach Calipari telling Allison on the way to the locker room that they're not playing strong, not playing tough. They've had nine first half turnovers. The game is a high contact game, and how are his young kids going to respond? Ultimately, I think it's going to boil down the next 20 minutes. Who wants to keep playing? And right now, you're done. You lose, you're done. And that's the challenge I think both coaches throw at their guys. Do you want to advance or do you not? And it's ultimately going to boil down to a tough man's game in the second 20 minutes. You look at Robert Morris, they come in making over eight threes per game. They've only made three, so they have the lead without doing what they do best. And for Kentucky, it's been Archie Goodwin, the only guy other than Jared Polson to me that hasn't been afraid of the moment.
Let's check in with Allison.
Hey guys, I talked to Coach Tool at the half, and he said they had success early in this game because of movement. They moved their body, they moved the ball well. As the game went on, they did not. Earlier, they were able to get good shots because of that movement. He said they have to be stronger in their cutting and in their screening. The challenge, though, in the second half is they have to do it with so many personal fouls, 13 team fouls, five players with two apiece. It's a major concern to them in the second half.
Well, Andy Tool, a disciple not only of Mike Rice, but also of Fran Dunphy, played as a guard at Penn for Fran Dunphy. And sounds like the exact type of things that Mike Rice or Fran Dunphy might say after a half that ended the way it did for Robert Morris, losing a double-digit lead, not losing the lead overall, though, still up by one.
Well, I think what he's saying is what we've been talking about the whole first half. Kentucky has been young defensively all year. That's not going to change. Young guys, when it gets uncomfortable, a lot of times they run away from the action instead of stepping up to the action. So if you're Robert Morris in this half, you have to make Kentucky defend the fourth, the fifth, and the sixth pass. Can they do it, and will they do it?
It's a very important early second half foul call, too, on Lucky Jones. His third sends him to the bench. Cauley Stein has problems with the alley-oop and has to feed it back outside. And then Archie Goodwin called for an offensive foul.
Why would Willie Cauley Stein give up the basketball right underneath the rim? He's 7-1, Bob, the last time I checked. And you just go up with the basketball and dunk the ball on whoever's closest to you. Prior to him making that pass, he was underneath the rim with the basketball, and he's 7 feet tall.
Goodwin commits his second foul. Delton Jones drives, uses a little bit of English, and extends the lead to three.
Good tough drive. Willie Cauley Stein got drug away from the rim initially, but then he stood and watched the action of Jones on the drive and didn't recover.
Poitras comes up short, saves it, but it's right to Caron Williams. It's a 5-on-4. The extra pass underneath. But cleaning up was Poitras. He was the late man back and got the block.
Poitras is a slow-release three-point shooter. Now, he shoots a high percentage, 42-43%, but he only takes one a game. Such a slow release, Robert Morris is able to recover.
Whistle away from the ball. And down on the floor and injured is Anthony Myers Pate. And it looks as if it might be another cramping issue as they're going to try and stretch him out as quickly as they can. We already saw Anthony Myers Pate go to the bench in the first half with a cramp, but this looks like a lot more serious. He is really in pain.
He seems starting to cramp up right there. He's already hopping. And well, initially, you just have to drop. There's nothing you can do once you get to that spot with your body. And he lays out. And it's about 100 degrees in the chuck right now. 30-something outside. And Young man is in a lot of pain.
Now, if you were in this building right now, a building that theoretically holds a little over 3,000, but seems like they have suspended the maximum capacity at least for tonight, as they are standing about six deep behind each basket, on top of the fact that there's not a seat empty in either of the bleachers on both sides of the court, and that has raised the temperature in here significantly. It's hot.
Yeah,
and it's not hard to understand why a player would have a cramping problem.
Yeah, all these people back here, well, this is the end of the floor where they're standing five or six deep. And you're just getting a glimpse of the action on that end of the floor.
Now again, Anthony Myers-Pate went to the bench in the first half. And this is back in the first half as he went through with a little after the whistle layup attempt and came up lame. And then he was over on the bench. And now again here, he could just barely move. And he is still down with the training staff trying to help him work it out.
If it's cramps, then at some point, you know, you got to get him up and get him off the floor. And, you know, you carry him off and you get him off to the side, you clean up the spot. We get back to the action. That doesn't look like the signs of a guy that's going to be back anytime soon.
So they will bring him to the end of the bench and probably try to get him hydrated as quickly as possible. Anthony Myers-Pate started tonight's game, but Velton Jones, Carvell Anderson, and Caron Williams all average more points per game than Myers-Pate. So it's not like Robert Morris loses a lot of offense, but they certainly lose depth.
Bob, Willie Cauley-Stein has to play like a seven-footer in this game if Kentucky is going to advance. He has to.
Line drive jumper is good for Archie Goodwin, and it's a one-point game again. And Goodwin, the first Kentucky player in double figures. Elton Jones, old-school floater, off the glass.
Boy, he is tough and crafty, isn't he? Velton Jones, the heartbeat of this ball club. And you can just whip the guy that's guarding you, you're sending a message, and Velton Jones just did.
Long jumper off the front rim. Julius Mays is still scoreless. He averages 9.5 points a game, but has not been able to get on the board tonight.
But Julius Mays is a catch and shoot guy, and you make Julius Mays rhythm dribble or bounce it into his shot, you've done your job defensively.
Velton Jones again. Slows up and has a little Earl the Pearl Monroe finish to his game, and it makes it a five-point Robert Morris lead.
I talked about him being crafty, and that time the ball fake, he really sold it and got two defenders to get arms up, and then he attacks the hip, and he does it with a slow man's game, no burst at all about him, just smart.
Mays down the lane, lost it, found it again, gets trapped under the backboard, and has to play up top to Goodwin. Archie Goodwin, floating left, shoots back to the right, and he's got 12.
Again, Archie Goodwin and Polson, to me, the two most consistent guys right now in terms of wanting to fight, wanting to be tough, wanting to win. Can they drag a couple of guys with them with 15:40 to go and try to stay alive in the NIT?
Deep position for Mike McFadden, and he forces a foul call.
Velton Jones is as durable of a point guard as the NEC has seen in recent years. No burst, but smart, high IQ guy. Has a 40-year-old body and a 40-year-old mind, but right now putting up points.
All right, Chris, thanks very much. Both of the Joneses now on the bench for Robert Morris. As Velton Jones with three field goals here in the second half sits down. And Lucky Jones has just come back on. Lucky Jones able to set up Apollon, but he throws up a brick. So Kentucky down by three. Poitras attacks a little too strong, tapped around. And here comes Robert Morris the other way. Lucky Jones for three. Knocks it down. Plus the foul. A chance for a four-point play as Wiltshire fouled Lucky Jones on the triple.
In transition, Kyle Wiltshire again doesn't get his heels out beyond the three-point line. And he's guarding a guy that has shot over 50% from the three-point line in this building. Wiltshire's out of position. He's buried. His hands aren't up. And Lucky Jones is at the line.
Lucky Jones has been in foul trouble for a fair portion of the night. But with three fouls, Andy Toole brings him back in. And he connects on a four-point play to make it a seven-point lead for Robert Morris. A little old-school toss off the window for Ryan Harrow, and he's called for an offensive foul. Keith Armstrong took the charge.
As the point guard, it's not about beating your guy. It's about beating the second defender and reading the second defender. Now, it looked like Robert Morris, 45 steps up after Harrow had left the floor. And to me, Armstrong was in position, and then he stepped up after Harrow had left the floor. I think it was a bad call, but regardless, Harrow has to read that second defender quicker.
And Velton Jones back in the game. He takes over at point guard once again for Robert Morris. Lucky Jones fouled on a touch by Julius Mays. Kentucky has not gotten a friendly whistle through the first 5.5 minutes of the second half. And I think John Calipari might be within his rights to react the way he is. As a touch foul here, a player sliding under the other at the opposite end for what probably should not have been an offensive foul. Kyle Wiltshire didn't hit Lucky Jones real hard on the four-point play. Robert Morris getting a friendly whistle early in the second half.
Well, if you're Kentucky, you have to play through it. If not, you're going to go home. You're going to feel bad about it, but you're going to go home regardless. You toughen up, you play through it.
Velton Jones finds Lucky Jones.
Not guarding the basketball is a problem on that one, instead of a whistle by the official.
Timeout, Kentucky.
Velton Jones is not a quick kid. But number two in blue has a will to win that's very hard to take away from this guy. He just makes plays. Robert Morris up nine.
Wischusen, Jimmy Dykes, Allison Williams, bringing you first round action in the NIT. Robert Morris taking on the number one overall seed, Kentucky, but getting the benefit of the home court in spite of the fact that technically they're the road team. And Jimmy, they have taken advantage.
This is what I wanted to see out of Kentucky all night long, was Willie Cauley-Stein posting up with a purpose on the block. On the other end of the floor, though, Kentucky has to start guarding the ball. John Hood is 6'7". He's guarding Belton Jones, and John Hood is not down in his stance. He's not low, and John Calipari talked about being low when he went off to the half with Allison. That's low on offense and lower on defense. Hood doesn't get lower than the guy he's guarding. The step through, Belton Jones makes the play. This game is going to be won by the team that is stronger and lower for the next 13 minutes.
That foul for Robert Morris on Caron Williams, his third. And he's guarding the ball now against Julius Mays. Paulson down the lane. He's fouled, and he'll go to the line to shoot two. How important is Belton Jones to Robert Morris? Well, this is how important he has been through his entire career. Number one in Robert Morris history in starts, and the top five in points, assists, and free throws made. He's only the ninth player in the history of the NEC to be over 1,500 points and over 500 assists.
And now he's 10 assists shy of the school record. I mean, he came in tonight 13 away. He's already got three. Well, those kind of guys are just hard to beat. You know, he's not blessed with great athletic ability, but he's great. He's blessed with great leadership qualities. In the last TV timeout, he was not on the floor when play resumed, but he went out and talked and touched all five guys before he went and sat down on the bench. Things that leaders do naturally with instincts, this kid does.
A little life, though, for the Wildcats, as off the free throw miss, they get a new possession after an offensive rebound. Leaning in is Goodwin. Comes up short as he got an open look at point-blank range.
Goodwin tried to shoot a right-handed layup on the left side of the rim when he had space to go with a natural left hand.
Way off the mark on that three attempt, Belton Jones. John Hood pushes the other way. Olsen again penetrates, leaves for Hood. Another offensive foul call. And that's a huge call as Lucky Jones took the charge. He is shaken up. Had he been called for a block, it would have been his fourth. So we'll see if Lucky Jones can stay on the floor. And it looks like he will.
But we talked about it in the first half. Robert Morris defensively, they're a shrink the gap team. That's who they've been all season long. You're not going to get to the rim on a shrink the gap defensive club on the first or second pass. Kentucky has to get ball reversal, make Robert Morris work. They're not going to get there to the rim in early offense.
Fadden lost it. Lucky Jones found it. He'll try a medium range jumper, and he'll knock it down. And the lead's back up to 10 for Robert Morris. Am I right to say that this game right now is teetering on the brink for Kentucky?
It's kind of had that feel all night long. Even when Kentucky would, you know, cut it down to 2 points, you just like they're holding on.
Poitras inside. This time Lucky Jones tries a flop, and Poitras is able to lay it in as the officials don't fall for the flop. And John Calipari's about four steps out on the court looking for an end one. Carvell Anderson on the drive. The tip inside for Mike McFadden.
Kentucky switches up top on the ball screen, get a little bit of an advantage and drive right through Goodwin. And not rotating over again hurts Kentucky.
Terrific play though by Paulson. The spin through traffic and the lead for Poitras.
It kind of tells you where Kentucky is, maybe tonight and all season long. Paulson, the guy that can make plays for Kentucky better than anyone else. He has been their best play starter.
Russell Johnson on the drive. Finesses one off the window.
Bob, again, the lower guy won. Robert Morris being pressured up top. The guy with the basketball became the lower player and gets all the way to the rim. Very simple fundamental of basketball.
Goodwin through a double team gets help. That will go against Russell Johnson.
In a game of toughness, the lower guy wins, and Russell Johnson lowered his waist, lower than Poitras, and then there's the blow by. You've got Kentucky, the winningest program in the history of college ball on your home floor. It means something to Robert Morris right now.
All right, Chris, thanks very much. And as we took a look at that Sir Dominic Poynter fadeaway jumper to win it for St. John's, they advance. How about the celebration in the background of our old colleague Steve Lavin?
Absolutely.
Leaping into his assistant's arms out on the floor. Feels good when you break a five-game losing streak and you advance in tournament play, even if it's not the tournament.
Now, you and I both covered this tournament for years, and it's, well, who's hungry in that first game is so important. Who really wants to be in this tournament? So far, these kids from Robert Morris, nothing I've seen from them, from the shoot around to their warm-up period to how they played, tells me anything different. Willie Cauley-Stein continues to be fronted defensively on the low post, and they're continuing to back him out of the action. Again, not playing low, not playing strong. Things that Calipari's talked with his young guys about all season long.
And Paulson has to reset with 10 on the shot clock. Gives it up to Julius Mays. Paulson penetrates, lobs one. Cauley-Stein can't handle it. And I guess that wasn't as much a lob as it was a line drive that went right through his hands. In the corner at the other end. A triple rattles home for Russell Johnson. the largest lead for Robert Morris, up to 13. Poitras out of a double team. Finally, Cauley Stein able to take advantage.
Good job by Poitras to catch the basketball, knowing that Robert Morris has been doubling that low block. And he caught it, knowing that the defense was coming at him, and he caught it with his shoulder squared to where the action was going to come from. Makes that pass much quicker.
Amazing to see Anthony Myers-Pate back on the floor handling the basketball. He was carried off the floor earlier this half with cramping issues. And we also saw Lucky Jones during the last timeout dealing with cramping issues. Shot clock down to four. Step back three. Myers-Pate too strong. Mays looking for his first field goal. Still can't buy one. But he'll go to the free throw line when we come back.
Well, Kentucky's going to have to understand they're in a fist fight with 7:44 to go. Poitras catches the basketball where he can see where the help's going to come from. Makes him a much quicker passer than Willie Cauley-Stein dunks at the end.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by Wendy's, proud sponsor of
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by Wendy's, proud sponsor of the 2013 John R. Wooden Men's Player of the Year Award, and Toyota Scion. See your local Scion dealer.
The Kentucky Wildcats trailing right now by 11 in the first round of the NIT. 1 year after winning a national championship. So, Jimmy Dykes, we take a look at their signees coming in next season. Where is this program right now moving forward?
Well, John Calipari, although he struggled this year with his recruiting philosophy, is not going to change. Nothing has changed about this guy in terms of being out in front of handling the one-and-done era of college basketball. So he's gone out and he's already has on the dotted line the number one recruiting class for next year. I think it's interesting that tomorrow on ESPNU, Julius Randle, who's the number one power forward, the number three player overall, is going to make his announcement where he's going to attend college next season. It's down to Kansas, Kentucky, Florida, and Texas. If he chooses Kentucky, then on paper, you could legitimately say that Kentucky has signed or will have the best recruiting class in the history of college basketball. That's what this kid would do with Kentucky's already locked in class for next year. The guys he has that we saw in that graphic is, I think, is the best shooting class in terms of guys that can just jump up and shoot the basketball that Calipari's ever signed. And if Julius Randle joins that group tomorrow, then It's just hold on for the rest of the nation.
That jumper won't go, but a foul called underneath, and it looks like that might go against Polson. Let's check. The 2013 NCAA Women's Basketball Championship tips off Saturday at 11 a.m. Eastern on ESPN2 and online at ESPN3. Catch every moment of the tournament on the ESPN family of networks and find information on every championship at NCAA.com, the home for all 89 NCAA championships.
You know, Bob, what's interesting is what will Kentucky look like next year, because they won national championship last year with a blend of that outstanding recruiting class, but John Calipari had really good upperclassmen to match it. So what does this year's Kentucky team return next year? Well, you lose Mays as a senior, but other than that, the question marks, Kyle Wilcher, he's going to be back. He's not going anywhere. Ryan Harrow, I don't know if he's good enough to play for Kentucky when those other guys coming in. And what role is he going to have? Just call it like I see it right now. Goodwin, Poitras, Willie Cauley-Stein, they're being projected as still first-round draft picks. I don't see it. I mean, those guys need another year or two in college ball. There's a huge difference in being draftable and being able to make an NBA roster. If you're not careful, you find yourself in the D-League for a couple of years, playing for the Maine Red Claws or the Sioux Falls Sky Force or the Fort Wayne Mad Ants, staying in hotel rooms that have outside doors. That's not what you want. You're better off playing for Kentucky another year or two than going into that D-League, I think, where it's a grown man's league, where you're fighting every day just to keep a roster spot. And the skill level, the maturity level, all those things, to me, Goodwin, Poitras, and Stein all could greatly benefit for another year under Calipari.
It's a fascinating situation that Kentucky finds themselves in, and a fascinating situation that Robert Morris finds themselves in as well. They still have a 9-point lead. Here's Lucky Jones forcing himself into Poitras, and they will call a foul on Alex Poitras. So that will put Lucky Jones back at the free throw line to try and put Robert Morris back up by double figures with 6.5 minutes to go in a game that is quite simply the biggest sporting event on the history of this campus, and it has had that vibe all day. And that's because Kentucky's here. And you think about, as you mentioned, the recruiting class. Normally, the outgoing group of freshmen are outgoing at Kentucky because they're headed to the NBA. But if this group of freshmen actually decides to stay to supplement what could be, as you said, the biggest recruiting class in the history of college basketball next year, if they get Randall tomorrow, you could go from national championship to knocked out of the NIT in the first round to preseason top five.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
You know, when have you ever seen that before in the history of college basketball?
Well, John Calipari is in a lot of things you haven't seen before in the history of college basketball. You know, this is a guy that, look at how he coaches and how he fights. He's never given up on his kids this year. But Kentucky's not for everyone. And John Calipari says that very point blank in his recruiting process. This is a great example of it tonight. Kentucky's not for everyone, because you go on the road in the NIT, the building's rocking. There's a lot of heat in the building. The atmosphere can make you do things you don't want to do. And only Kentucky can bring this type of a crowd to Robert Morris on the opening night of the NIT.
Jared Polson continues to hold Kentucky in. He's made back-to-back baskets both times to cut the lead down to single digits. And he is now in double digits.
Say that again. What's Polson doing?
He's 4-for-4 from the field. A turnover by Lucky Jones, and he continues to be the guy that's holding them in this game.
That's my point. Jared Polson continues to be the guy that's holding them in this game. And you look around at Cauley-Stein and Kyle Wilcher, who's played in that national championship game, Alex Poitras, who's a top 10 national recruit. And Jared Polson is the guy. He and Archie Goodwin, I think Archie Goodwin has fought in this ballgame.
Wilcher in and out, a wide open look from three, and that would have been a big momentum swing had he knocked that down. The look on Andy Toole's face as that ball rimmed out. He knows his team dodged a bullet there.
Kentucky's got a guard. It's not easy to guard when your shots aren't falling. You're down 9 points on the road.
Back-to-back traveling calls. The first on Lucky Jones, that one on Velton Jones. Those are the first two turnovers for Robert Morris in the second half. They basically played 15 minutes of turnover-free basketball against Kentucky Can they hold on in the last 5 minutes?
Yeah, Kentucky hasn't put any pressure on them defensively, Bob. And Kentucky has not been good guarding the first step of Robert Morris in this game. On the other end, Robert Morris has really struggled guarding the first step of Archie Goodwin.
Elton Jones called for his third, team foul number six. So both teams are now out of fouls to give. We'll shoot free throws the rest of the way with 5 minutes to go.
Now there's a culture or a smell of winning around Robert Morris. They've been to two NCAAs in the last 6 years. One of the top 10 winningest mid-major programs over the last 5 years. They're used to winning 23, 24 games per year. They have not backed down from Kentucky's the name on the front of the jersey for 1 second.
Knocking down a three, though, from the corner is Julius Mays. What a time for Mays to pick up his first field goal of the night and make it a six-point game with 4.5 to go.
Now Kentucky has to guard the ball. Can they guard the ball back-to-back possessions and then score back-to-back possession?
Carvell Anderson can't answer. Ollie Stein the rebound. Here come the Wildcats. Down by six.
For Kentucky, fortunate though, Wilcher got buried in the lane, gave up an open three.
Ollie Stein sets up Wilcher. He'll float one off the window. Gets it to roll home. The Wildcats putting together a run. They're down by four. Timeout called by Andy Toole. A 7-0 Kentucky run over the last 2 minutes.
Well, it all started with Julius Mays off of the nice bounce pass by Polson out on the perimeter. Very well thrown pass, and then Willie Colley-Stein gives it up on the right block and finds Kyle Wilcher, who they chase him off the three-point line and very much under control uses the board. And Kentucky now starting to throw a few punches themselves. They're going to have to punch away with 3:52 to go.
Trying to make it a pleasant homecoming for John Calipari. Remember, Moon Township, Pennsylvania is where we're at tonight, and he played for Moon Area High School, the class of 78, and he went on to play about an hour away at Clarion College, 1981-82, and then went on to become an assistant coach at Pitt. So his roots not only planted in the Pittsburgh area, but in the backyard of the town we're in. Grandmother, when this was a Division III school, Robert Morris was a cafeteria worker here on campus. So much of the most cherished memories of John Calipari's life happening right here in this neighborhood. This hasn't been a good memory so far, but they're trying to turn it around. Archie Goodwin hammered. That's an intentional foul. And Goodwin's angry. Lucky Jones hammered Archie Goodwin. Did he make a play on the ball? It was a violent play at that. And it was immediately signaled by Gary Prager to be a flagrant foul.
That is a flagrant one easily, and a terrific job by Jared Polson to step in and get Archie Goodwin under control. That may be viewed as more than a flagrant one. I mean, you're taking a guy's head off right here. Bam. They'll go to the monitor and check this one again, I promise.
right, Chris, thanks very much. Bob Wischus and Jimmy Dykes watching Lucky Jones walk off the floor for the final time tonight. He has been ejected. Jimmy Dykes, the officials went to the monitor. This foul on Archie Goodwin was immediately signaled a flagrant one. They have the right to go to the monitor and determine what. That results now in Lucky Jones being ejected.
And they can upgrade that flagrant one to flagrant two when they go to the monitor and look at it. And this is a perfect example of extreme and or severe contact. That's what separates flagrant two from flagrant one. Flagrant one is excessive contact. Flagrant two is extreme or severe. And that was extreme and severe. The right call in a tough, tough spot right now for Robert Morris. They lose Lucky Jones, Archie Goodwin with the free throws and the ball, and Kentucky is more than right back in this basketball game.
A chance for Kentucky on this possession now to tie or take the lead, as now without Lucky Jones, Andy Toole urges his group on to try and get a stop and hold on to the lead.
And you maybe have lit a fire even more so under Archie Goodwin. They lit him up. This is a competitive young man up top with that ball.
Mays floats one and just coming up short. Trying to take the lead was Cauley Stein. But the second effort by Archie Goodwin on the putback. And we are tied at 53.
I'm telling you, the flagrant two foul on Archie Goodwin, I think it's going to take Archie Goodwin to another level with 3 minutes to go. You can see it in his eyes. He looks different after he got his neck wrung. He could take over this game.
Elton Jones leans in on Goodwin. And a foul called on Archie Goodwin. So that is going to put Elton Jones at the line to try and give Robert Morris the lead back.
Watch Archie Goodwin come in and, again, just make a dirty basket, a tough basket, a have-to basket out of Goodwin. His body language to me looks different now than prior to the time that he went down with a hard foul on him. He's responding exactly how you want a guy to respond when he gets knocked like that.
Let's check in with Allison.
Yeah, guys, Archie was definitely upset after that foul, and Coach Cal tried to just calm him down in the huddle. He looked him in the eyes and he said, look, if you're out of this game, we lose. And he just told him he's got to keep it together out there for his team. Archie just kind of nodded his head, seeming to agree. And the other thing Coach Cal was saying during that last timeout, this game is going to come down to defense and rebounding.
Well, Coach Cal right on top of him. He can't afford for Archie Goodwin to lose his discipline. How hard you can compete without losing your discipline is always that fine line that champions walk. If you're Archie Goodwin right now, you don't pull yourself back from this moment. You take what happened to you, and now you try to finish off this Kentucky comeback with some extra juice.
The first round of the NCAA Division I Men's Basketball Championship continues tomorrow on True TV, beginning at 6:30 p.m. For more information on tournament game times and listings, go to NCAA.com. Here in the first round of the NIT, Bob Wischus and Jimmy Dykes, Allison Williams, and what has been a great place to be tonight. Spirit-wise, everything we could have hoped for. Having looked, though, at these last, say, couple of minutes, Kentucky pulling a comeback. Those points by Elton Jones were the first points in over 3.5 minutes for Robert Morris. So what has to happen for the Colonials to hold on and please the crazies behind us?
Well, the building's going to have a lot of heat and a lot of electricity with under 3 minutes to go. And John Calipari all season long has been dragging his guys along in the fight department and not backing down from a challenge and backing down from a fight. Well, they find themselves in one again in the first round of the NIT. Robert Morris, an older team, has won 7 games this year, decided by 5 points or less. So they've been tested in tough battles. But they're without Lucky Jones, the most versatile all-around guy.
Paulson, tough shot. The tip followed by Goodwin won't go. And a rebound in traffic to Russell Jensen. He needs some help. Paulson just about picked his pocket in the backcourt.
What has Robert Morris done best in this half? They've isolated and driven the ball with success.
Elton Jones has Cauley Stein caught on a switch. Size mismatch underneath. A little head fake. He goes right around him. Yep. Gets it up for the dunk to Mike McFadden.
They isolated and drove the ball with success. That's what they've done the entire second half. They go to it one more time.
Cauley Stein answers. And it's a two-point game again. 90 seconds to go.
You're Robert Morris. Nothing should change. Isolation and drive the ball. Andy Toole may take a timeout to talk about it, but that has been their best offense. Again, the end of the drive is not what it is. It's the isolation up top. They go to a ball screen action, they get the switch, and all of a sudden, it's a five guarding a one. Willie Cauley Stein being the five. There's the action. They've isolated. The isolation is five guarding a one. One backs up, five is going to raise up, and then one with a blow by, and then finish at the rim. Very good play call and execution by Robert Morris, staying with their strength.
If you're John Calipari, are you expecting the same type of a set coming out of the timeout? And how do you adjust if you don't switch the ball screen? Can Belton Jones get a three off? What are you worried about?
That's the concern, because Robert Morris in this building, they've shot over 40% from three all season long. And if you don't switch out, then you're also giving up a, you know, turn into the shoulder three-point shot. So Kentucky will probably have to still switch the action. If you get caught on a switch, you must stay low, you must stay determined, and fight off the drive. Can Kentucky delete the drive right now?
Take the shot clock down and set things up with Myers Pate. And now Belton Jones takes over with 10 to shoot. Lost the dribble. Saves it in no man's land, but they'll say he stepped on the end line first.
How about that? Robert Morris was going to go with an isolation and a baseline drive. They popped their big man to create the drive alley, and Belton Jones couldn't control the basketball.
I'm not sure if there was a clock issue, as John Calipari was all the way out to midcourt and had to be told by Matt Potter, one of the officials, to get back in the coach's box. He received a coach's box warning earlier in the game, and it now looks like they will head to the monitor and possibly adjust the clock with Robert Morris up by a basket.
Here's the isolation play, and watch Jones, he loses it. Yeah, 101, it should be at 101.
About a second and a half extra came off the clock than should have.
I think it's a good call, a good catch by the Kentucky bench. That's what they're out of their coaching box. You always have, at least most coaches, they have an assistant coach assigned when you get around 2 minutes to go in the ball game. They are assigned. You are my clock coach. You're my clock coach. Yeah, when the ball hit the official out of bounds, it was at 101, and that's when the clock should stop. But you should have a clock coach on your bench. That's your assignment. You make sure that clock is matching up when the ball's going out of bounds. And I don't know who it is for John Calipari, but they are on top of it, and it saves Kentucky what could be two very important seconds in this game. This place has been nuts. An hour and a half before tip-off, and it's still rocking.
This has been a fun place to
be
all night. Under a minute to go. Can Robert Morris hold on?
What's Kentucky done well? Archie Goodwin driving the ball has been good offense for Kentucky.
Archie Goodwin leans in here and ties the game.
Archie Goodwin driving the ball is what Kentucky's doing best. Robert Morris has multiple guys that can drive the ball. Bob, remember, low guy wins right now. Low guy will win if it's a one-on-one battle.
And about a 7-second differential.
Toole has two timeouts left.
He's going to let him play. 8 seconds to shoot. Felton Jones in the corner, picks up his dribble, now calls a timeout with 5 seconds on the shot clock.
That is shocking to me that you drive the ball to the corner and call timeout, because that is a very tough spot to get that ball inbounds.
Can't imagine that that's what Andy Toole wanted.
But, I mean, I don't know. You go back and watch, and Andy Toole is directing his guy down to the corner to call timeout. Andy Toole is saying, bring the ball down right here and call timeout. Now, I'm not going to question it, because he knows his guys and he knows his out-of-bounds plays better than I do, and more importantly, better than Kentucky does with a short turnaround. But I'm just telling you, that's not an easy spot to get that ball in bounds.
Andy Toole was pointing to the baseline as we go back and look at Archie Goodwin's tying basket.
Archie Goodwin has made tough play after tough play in this ball game. And when they tried to take his head off, Archie Goodwin went to another level in terms of how he was competing. And he might be the reason Kentucky can find a way to win this game. If I'm Kentucky, I tell you what, I put pressure on this out-of-bounds play right now with 5 seconds on that shot clock, with the ball being out of bounds over there in the corner but in front of the water cooler.
Felton Jones throws it in with 5 seconds to shoot.
I don't like the angle for Poitras.
A block inside by Corey Stein. The follow won't go for Mike McFadden, but he draws the foul. 8.7 seconds to go.
I did not like the angle of Alex Poitras guarding the ball out of bounds. Look where he is, jumping up and down. His shoulders are square. And he has got to be the guy taking away the pass to the rim. 22 in white. Boy, a hustle play by Mike McFadden. Right over here is the action I'm talking about.
So Kentucky will spend a timeout here before the free throws from Mike McFadden.
Not the best angle, but Alex Poitras has to be over here with his shoulder squared up, and he cannot allow this ball to be thrown this direction. You have to make sure that you take away that pass right there, and Poitras didn't do it. He was keeping the ball from being thrown up the sidelines. That passing going to hurt you. The ball being thrown to the rim, you have to take away, and Poitras on the ball didn't do it.
So in spite of the fact that Robert Morris called a puzzling timeout with the ball buried down in the deep corner, they seemed to get exactly what they wanted from that out-of-bounds underneath set.
Yeah, they got what they wanted because Poitras was out of position. I mean, Kentucky had him dead, man. They had him dead in the corner, and they couldn't take it away. And now McFadden stepped to the strike.
64% free throw shooter on the season. He replaced Lucky Jones after the flagrant two knocked Lucky Jones out of the game. Morris is back on top. Kentucky still has one timeout left. Will John Calipari spend a timeout?
Where's Archie Goodwin in all this action?
Mays gives it up. Wiltshire for three. Off the heel. No good. It's over. Robert Morris has beaten Kentucky.
Hold on, partner. Just hold on. Hey. No.
Take over.
Coach, simple question. I'm not sure it's a simple answer. How did you defeat Kentucky tonight?
I don't know. Our guys just played with so much toughness today. We had so many guys that were cramping on the other sideline down there. They continue to just continue and scream at each other to be tough, defend, stay in a stance, be detailed. I'm so happy for those guys. I know they were disappointed not getting to the NCAA tournament, but this is a memory they'll have for the rest of their lives.
Did you get the play you wanted after the called timeout in the corner?
We did. I mean, Russell got the ball right under the basket there, had an opportunity to lay it in. You know, we always talk about to our guys about continuing to play, not stopping. Mike McFadden with a great example of that. He stayed with the play, got a great opportunity, and then stepped up and made big free throws.
You lost Lucky Jones with 3:40 left in the game. How did you overcome that?
You know, Lucky played a great game, and he did so much to get us to where we were at. And that's why we coach everybody every day, because you never know when guys are going to have to make plays.
You told me before the game that you would not know the value of this game until afterwards. What is the value of this game and this win?
I still have no answer for you.
Pretty special, though.
Absolutely.
All right, Coach, thank you so much.
Thank you, guys.
Congratulations to Andy Toole and Robert Morris, NEC champions. And by luck of the draw, they end up with a home game against Kentucky, who's the first overall seed. And here's the final trip up the floor for the Wildcats.
Well, Jimmy, I think you would have wanted Archie Goodwin to bring that ball up the floor and be the first guy making the push, because they did not take away his drive ability really for much of the second half. Kyle Wilcher, 16, got a pretty good look right here. Can make contested threes, but it doesn't drop. Kentucky doesn't guard the out-of-bounds play when they had him dead in the corner. Archie Goodwin is not involved in the offense. And Robert Morris, as the eighth seed, sends the number one seed Kentucky Wildcats home, and the season's over.
We have a request in to ESPN Research as we speak to find out if this is the first ever first round NIT court storming. We believe it might be, as Robert Morris does it to Kentucky. And yes, we put the bronze plaque, Papa Shoes and Jimmy Dykes, Allison Williams and crew right here, as Robert Morris advances. And they will await the winner of Providence and Charlotte, as Velton Jones, Anthony Myers Pate fought through some cramps. Lucky Jones kicked out of the game. His replacement, Mike McFadden, comes on to hit what turns out to be the game-winning free throws. Washington, BYU, NIT coverage continuing in just a moment. Again, the final, 59-57. Robert Morris celebrates a win over the winningest program in college basketball history. What a scene. The NIT continues now. Let's head out to Provo, Utah. Okay.
The celebration continues here at the Chuck, and I'm not sure how late in the evening it will be before they can finally empty this place, as the Robert Morris Colonials fans are celebrating a win. And whether it was a win or a loss would have been the biggest moment sporting-wise in the history of this campus. And Jimmy Dykes, it was Robert Morris taking the punches and counter-punching in the second half that it seems allowed them to survive a furious Kentucky comeback in the last 8 minutes or so.
Well, first of all, what a moment for Robert Morris. You know, if you don't make the NCAA tournament, what would be your next best option? It would be to have the defending national champions and the winningest program in the history of college basketball, the Kentucky Wildcats, on your home floor on national TV. And Robert Morris seized the moment. Now, Kentucky showed some fight. I think John Calipari will say that his kids fought in the second half. But ultimately, it was the winning culture of Robert Morris that surfaced to the front. This is a program that's they're used to winning 23, 24 wins a season. They get their 24th win tonight. Their upperclassmen made plays. Lucky Jones made a bad play, almost cost them the ball game, but other guys stepped up. Very impressed with the heart and the tenacity of Velton Jones. This is a Robert Morris program that seized the moment. Kentucky came in. The building was hot 90 minutes prior to tip, and it stayed hot in a memorable night now for the Colonials.
And memorable to be a part of it. It was a fun place to be. Congratulations to Robert Morris. They're two wins away from Madison Square Garden as the celebration continues. A two-point win over Kentucky.
Stretch, and what was going through your mind when you were at the line?
Obviously it was big. It's Kentucky. It's a lot of people watching this game. You know, it's like it's big. You know, we could like we I had to push this out. I had to make these free throws. You know, I had to make something of myself. You know, we got a whole bunch of people supporting us. Everybody at home supporting us. I had to make this free throw. That's all it was.
What was the key to the defensive stance at the end to make sure that they did not tie it up or go ahead and get the shot off?
Basically it was just a scramble, you know. Everybody just decided that I made the two free throws. We just had to get back. You know, hopefully we just got the stop. We knew they had to force up a shot, you know, and pray that they missed it. Hopefully they did. So that's all it was. We won.
How big is this win?
It's extremely big. Everybody doubted us. You know, we was watching ESPN. Everybody thought Kentucky was going to win. They were supposed to win, obviously, but we wasn't allowing it. You know, we took it home today.
Mike, thank you.
Thank you, appreciate it.
1, 2, 3, 4, testing, mic check, 1, 2.
Where did all you people come from? Hey, tell those two, be careful. Don't put the chair back too far. Yes, questions.
But how about a person?
I mean, we just could never get it together, I guess. A big disappointment. Just couldn't find the way to compete, I guess. We never got together, and that's why we ended up here. Credit, they hit shots. They played probably their best game in the season, but yeah, I mean, we got some good wins, but then we came back and always got some bad losses, so I don't know. I guess it kind of sums it up.
So I just didn't want our season to end because I enjoy playing with these guys. And, you know, we had a bumpy road up to this point. But I felt that this was our chance to, you know, just show that we deserve the spot to be where we, like, or on a higher pedestal than where we are. But we're just going to get the win tonight. Found me hard. Taking my time on my free throws. This whole year I've been rushing and I've been caught shooting in different ways. But tonight I just, you know, focused on shooting one way and just taking my time with it and just getting all the negative thoughts out of my mind before shooting, and it worked out. Question of whether I'm going or not. I don't think I'm ready to go. It's no reason why I think any of our guys should really leave. We should come back next year and play with focus on the team that we have and just try to do better than what we did this year because we really, as a the expectations that we have for ourselves this year, we didn't meet them at all. We didn't come close to them. So I think that that's a way to just say that we should all come back.
Well, we've seen some very interesting.
Yeah, actually, it wasn't that loud to me because we've been played in front of 25,000 plus. So I don't think the crowd played a little bit, but not much of anything because there's nothing that we haven't seen before. Every time we go on the road, it's somebody's Super Bowl. Every game is sold out. So it's not. I don't think that was what it was affected us. They just made a lot of tough shots, and they played one of the better games of the year, and we weren't able to overcome it.
Just went to some dribble drive plays, try to get Archie in the lane for a pitch out or something like that. So just trying to drive the ball in their guards and just find the open man. And I mean, it worked out for the most part, but came up short.
Did you say 30 minutes?
Well, we're going to sit down. I told them out. We'll have individual meetings. I'm not ready to do that yet. We'll have individual meetings, and I told them out. The one thing is expect me to be honest. Expect me to be honest with them, and that's what I'll do. I'm just I'll be honest with every one of the guys, and we were discombobulated when we lost New Orleans. We thought we could recover, but we just weren't tough enough there. Let me say this. Robert Morris played a great basketball game, and let me tell you what they did. They just physically came in and said, these guys cannot withstand our physical toughness. Go at them. That's all they did. So whether it was us driving, whether we were trying to get open, whether it was them on offense, they played a physical, tough, hard-nosed basketball game. They took charges when they needed to, and we were down 10-0. Game was too rough. Just got too rough. And you sit there and you shake your head, and there were guys that couldn't play in the game. Just couldn't put them in because we were trying to win.